Penguin Audio presents Santa Fe Dead by Stuart Woods. Read by Michael Kramer. 1. Ed Eagle sat, all 6 feet 7 inches of him, propped up on many pillows in bed watching court TV on the 50-inch flat-screen television in the bedroom of his suite at the Hotel Bel Air in Los Angeles. He had decided to watch from bed rather than attend the trial of his former wife Barbara, since he had already spent 3 days in the courtroom giving his testimony against her. Now it was time for the summations. The prosecutor, a woman apparently in her mid-30s named Valerie Simmons, whom Eagle found quite attractive, had done a very good job in the trial, he thought, and since he was one of the half-dozen best trial lawyers in the western United States, his opinion counted for something. Now all Ms. Simmons had to do was nail the lid on the thing. Eagle would have preferred nailing and screwing the lid on it, but he would settle for nailing. Anything to get Barbara into a cell for the next 50 years or so. Eagle's girlfriend of the last year, the actress Susanna Wilde, came out of the bathroom, her hair wet, her robe hanging open. She crawled across his body, deliberately stroking his face with her breasts as she went, and snuggled up next to him. "Don't wave those things at me," Eagle said. "I have to watch Barbara go down."
"Wouldn't you rather watch me go down?" Susanna asked, tickling his lower belly.
"On another occasion, yes," he replied. "But right now you're going to have to contain yourself, as difficult as that may be."
Susanna sighed and pulled herself upright next to him, plumping her pillows.
"Oh, all right," she said.
Valerie Simmons rose and walked toward the jury. "Ladies and gentlemen," she said to them, "I want to thank you for your attention to what has been a lengthy trial. Now I want to summarize the evidence against Barbara Eagle as succinctly as I can. And I would remind you that everything I am about to say has been testified to by witnesses. You have heard from Ms. Eagle's former husband, Ed Eagle, how he first met Ms. Eagle when she was serving a prison sentence in New York for armed robbery, and as an accessory to the killing of her first husband during that robbery. You have heard how she was released on parole and moved to Santa Fe, New Mexico, where she renewed her acquaintance with Mr. Eagle, and how they came to be married a year or so later. You have heard how Mr. Eagle woke up one morning, having been drugged with the sleeping pill Ambien in his wine the night before, and found his wife gone, and how she had taken more than $1 million of his money from his bank accounts, and attempted to take $5 million more from his brokerage accounts, something he managed to forestall. You have heard how Mr. Eagle hired 2 private investigators to find his wife in Mexico, where she had fled, and how she shot one of the investigators and pushed the other overboard from a ferry in the Sea of Cortez. Both were lucky to survive. You have heard how she hired 2 men from Santa Fe to murder Mr. Eagle, and how one of them nearly succeeded. You have heard how she came back to the United States and checked into a resort in San Diego where she had her appearance altered by having her dark hair dyed blonde and with cosmetic surgery. You have heard how she then traveled to Los Angeles and contacted a friend, Mr. James Long, and how they had dinner together that evening at the Hotel Bel Air. You have heard that Mr. Eagle and a friend were also dining there and how he did not recognize Ms. Eagle because of her altered appearance. You have heard how Ms. Eagle, later that night, drugged her companion, Mr. Long, once again with Ambien, left his home, returned to the Hotel Bel Air, and sought out the suite of Mr. Eagle. You have heard how she entered the suite next door in error and shot Mr. and Mrs. Thomas Dittilla of New York, believing that they were Mr. Eagle and his friend. All of this is in evidence, and the weight of it is enough for you to send Ms. Eagle to prison for the rest of her life. I ask you to do just that. Thank you." Valerie Simmons sat down. The judge turned to the defense table.
"Mr. Karp," he said.
Richard Karp rose and faced the jury.
"Good morning," he said. "Ladies and gentlemen, this case is about reasonable doubt. If you believe that there is a reasonable doubt that Barbara Eagle killed Mr. and Mrs. Dittilla, and that is all that she is charged with,
then you are legally and morally bound to acquit her. Everything you have heard from the prosecution about Ms. Eagle's past and what she may or may not have done in Mexico is window dressing, nothing more. And none of what you have heard is supported by any material evidence, just the testimony of questionable witnesses. While you heard Mr. Eagle testify that he was drugged with Ambien, there is no scientific evidence to support that contention. What happened was that Mr. Eagle had too much to drink the evening before and overslept. The funds that Ms. Eagle took with her to Mexico, in a desperate attempt to remove herself from an abusive marriage, were marital funds, and she was legally entitled to take them. I would remind you that one of the two men allegedly hired to kill Mr. Eagle is dead, and the other could not pick Ms. Eagle out of a lineup. I would remind you that it is not a crime in the United States to shoot someone in Mexico in self-defense or to push someone off a boat in an attempt to defend herself from a rape, and you have heard that both of her attackers survived. I would remind you that, although Ms. Eagle and Mr. Long dined at the Bel Air the evening before the murder, you have also heard from Mr. Long that she spent the entire night in his bed in his home and did not return to the Bel Air to shoot Mr. Dottila, who you have heard was the son of the mafia kingpin Carmine Dottila, who also met a violent death. It is far more likely that Thomas Dottila was killed by his own associates or competitors than by Ms. Eagle. I would remind you that Mr. James Long underwent no testing for the drug Ambien, and he has testified that Ms. Eagle spent the night with him, indeed that they made love in the middle of the night. I would remind you that it is not a crime for a woman to have her appearance enhanced by her hairstylist and her cosmetic surgeon. He smiled knowingly. In fact, stripped to its relevant essentials, the prosecution's case is nothing more than a lot of hot air, backed only by the testimony of an angry ex-husband and the two private detectives he hired to bully and harass her, and to come into this court and lie about her. There is no physical evidence, no murder weapon, and no motive for the murders of two people Ms. Eagle had never even met. I put it to you that the doubt of guilt in this case is not only reasonable, but overwhelming. And I ask you, after a careful examination of the evidence, or rather non-evidence, to acquit Barbara Eagle and set her free, so that she may still have a chance to find some happiness in what has so far been a life full of abuse and harassment by her ex-husband and others. Find her not guilty.
Carp sat down.
What do you think?
Susanna asked.
Well, they both said pretty much what I would have said if I had been prosecuting or defending, Eagle said. I think the jury will convict her.
Well then, Susanna said, while the jury is deliberating, may I distract you?
You may,
Eagle said, rolling over and taking her in his arms. She had been distracting him for 10 minutes or so when Eagle was redistracted by a sudden intensity in the voice of the court channel's anchor.
We are just getting word, the anchor said, that something has happened outside the courtroom where the trial of Barbara Eagle has just ended. Let's go to our reporter on the scene for the details.
A beautiful young woman in a red suit with perfect hair came on screen.
Well, she said breathlessly, it seems that Barbara Eagle has disappeared from the conference room where she and her lawyer were awaiting a verdict. Apparently, while Mr. Carp had excused himself to go to the men's room, Ms. Eagle somehow got out of the conference room, in spite of a guard on the door, and maybe even out of the building. A search is being conducted for her now.
Ed, Susanna said, you've gone all limp.
2. Barbara Eagle sat at the table in a conference room near the courtroom where she had just been tried, awaiting the jury's verdict. She had had lunch in this room every day during her trial, so she knew that it was on the first floor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.